Thank you very much for that, those kind words. In April, I was at a conference at Sandhurst, a World War II conference. At the conclusion of the conference, the commandant, a two-star, came to give some concluding remarks. And he explained that, of course, an important mission they have at Sandhurst is training their young lieutenants. And they like to give them various challenges and tactical problems. And they also like to throw in, as he explained, a moral challenge from time to time. So in a recent set of exercises, they took an episode out of D-Day, which involved the drop of a parachute battalion to seize the Miraville battery, which was a heavily fortified battery that had heavy guns that commanded the landing area. Well, when they got to the rendezvous point, instead of 740 troopers, they had 140 troopers. And you sort of think this is going one way. And then they threw in, and while you're at the rendezvous point, six French civilians appear. And Lieutenant, what do you do with the civilians? Well, this group goes off and comes back and says, well, we couldn't really agree. One part of the group says, let's shoot them out of hand. The other group says, no, 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 this is appalling. We can't do that. It's much too noisy. Let's take them to a barn and bayonet them. The moral issue is sort of a subtext of what I'm going to talk about tonight, but more importantly is the issue of China and its obscurity in our history. This was really driven home to me at an academic conference I was at in 2000. One of the subtopics of that conference was how the Pacific War between Japan and the U.S. was taught at high school level in textbooks in both Japan and the U.S. One day there was an exhibit of such textbooks, and I picked up one of the American textbooks and opened it up, and sure enough, on one page there was a table labeled Deaths in Axis Nations During World War II. I looked down the list, and it was reasonably complete, and the numbers seemed to be reasonable. I looked on the opposite page, and there was a table labeled Deaths in Allied Nations in World War II. And my eye ran down the list, and my brain immediately registered there was something wrong with this list. On second glance, I realized that China had been omitted from a list of allied nations participating in World War II. Now, this is the China that had fought for 97 months, from July of 1937 to August of 1945, by far the longest struggle of any of the allied powers. The war inflicted stupendous physical devastation and a colossal death toll in China. The Chinese now refer to this as the War of Resistance. I currently would not hesitate to use a list of death toll in China at about 15 million. This slide, oops, where am I going? Over here? Oh, wait a minute. Maybe if I turn it on, it'll work a little better. There we go. Okay. This slide indicates some of the more recent scholarship about the war and the numbers that are typically bandied about. And as you'll see, as usual, I try to go at the low end level. It's still, these are stunning numbers. For another recent project I did, I tried to grapple with the total death toll during the Asia Pacific War. Now, obviously, this is extremely difficult and no one can certify the exact numbers. But where I ended up in this effort, with some highlights, and one would be that I think the total number of deaths in the Asia-Pacific phase of the war probably were in the range of 25 million. Of these, only about 6 million were combatants. Of the 19 million non-combatant deaths, only about a million, perhaps less, were Japanese, which means that for every Japanese non-combatant who perished, about 18 others did. And of these non-combatants, about 12 million were Chinese. Now, carrying this exercise one step further in this sort of exercise and examining the death tolls. The excellent book by Timothy Snyder called Bloodlands says that on September 1st, 1939, when Hitler invaded Poland, Hitler at that point had been responsible for the deaths of about 10,000 human beings. By that point, Snyder figures Stalin had killed about 8 million. By that same date, September 1939, on a linear projection, about 4 million Chinese had died. If you fast forward to June 22nd, 41, which is when Hitler, of course, attacked the Soviet Union. As best I can calculate, by that point, Hitler was responsible for about over 600,000 deaths from all causes, including German deaths. Stalin had added about over 200,000 deaths, mostly Poles and Finns. And by that date, on a linear projection, about 7.5 million Chinese had died. These numbers, I think, are stunning and illustrate the degree to which we simply have forgotten the suffering and sacrifice of China. Now, why have we omitted this? I think there are several reasons, the first of which is sort of parochialism. For most Americans, World War II begins with Pearl Harbor in December 1941. That basically is halfway through the war for China. Secondly, I would count skewed or absent coverage. One of the problems with starting your concept of World War II in December 1941 is that this marked a period, or shortly afterward, marked a period when the American attitude towards the efforts of the Chinese nationalists soured. And it became inferred or implied that basically what was characteristic of that effort, say in 1944, had also characterized what had happened from 37 to 41. But overwhelmingly, I think the most important reason is simply the lack of source material. After the triumph of Mao Zedong in 1949, American scholars were cut off for decades from any archival material from the People's Republic, and the situation was not a whole lot better with respect to across the Taiwan Straits in Formosa, Taiwan. Now, after Sheng died in 1975 and Mao died the following year, there began a process in the following years of the release of archival documents that simply had never seen the light of day before. Those documents have been worked by Chinese and Western scholars, and I'm really the beneficiary and sort of the drummer for this effort. And what I want to present to you basically is sort of a highlight reel of what these documents tend to show us about the role of China in World War II. Now, before I go on the specific details, I want to make two general observations about this material. The first thing is that I noticed was that whereas in the People's Republic, of course, during Mao's lifetime, the war was really not emphasized. It was the revolution that was emphasized. And it was presented as an example of the singular genius, both political and military, of Mao Zedong. Since Mao's death, one of the scholars told me that one of the interesting phenomena is that as China's become richer, they've been able to fund historians in various provinces in China. And those historians in those provinces of China have been discovering all kinds of evidence that, well, we didn't all exactly march the same drummer boy of Mao Zedong. Every province sort of went its own way, or at least there was significant deviation from Mao's singular vision. The most startling thing by far, and it took quite a while for me to finally begin to credit this, is that at this time in the People's Republic of China, the fellow we refer to as Chiang Kai-shek is now a respected figure in most quarters. And I would venture that basically you can go to a lot of places in the People's Republic now where the treatment of Chiang Kai-shek is a lot more respectful than it will be found in the average American university or college campus. Now, another further step of the sort of stage setting is, you know, what was the old version of China and its role in the war? You'll find in most of the English language and Western literature. The most distinctive feature was probably the limited role assigned to China in the war. While they acknowledged the Chinese tied down a lot of Japanese, beyond that, very little is said about what China actually contributed to the war. The other almost universal feature about this is the moderate to very severely critical portrait of Chiang Kai-shek and his regime from 1937 all the way through the war. He's given very little credit for anything he did before 37, and even less for anything he accomplished during the war. His leadership is usually depicted as inept, corrupt, and basically ineffectual. The literature also, of course, features the figure of, here's our friend Chiang, of course, Joseph Stilwell, the American proconsul who sent to to China, the China-Burma-India Theater, in the early months of 1942. Stilwell has enjoyed quite a happy experience with American historians now for a number of decades. Usually he's depicted as sort of a martyr who attempted to speak truth to power, that the US was making a bad bet on Chiang. He's depicted as having had a sound basis of strategy in the early part of 1942 in trying to hold Burma, which the Chiang and the Chinese generals rejected to the disastrous conclusion. Then, of course, there's a further conflict in the following years of the war, where he conflicts with Claire Chennault, the American air commander in China, who prefers an air power-based strategy, whereas Stilwell sees it as a ground campaign to reopen the Burma Road to China. So how does this now stack up compared to what I think you can find in this new history? Well, there's a historian in the People's Republic, in an article that was published here, who described this old history that was to be found in People's Republic as follows, quote, partial in arguments, simplistic in conclusions, and abundant in falsehoods, unquote. And I find this painfully close to where we are now with respect to the old literature. Let me turn now to what, or at least some of the aspects of what this new history shows us actually about the war. What I'd like to try to do is illuminate what I think are some of the most revealing aspects of what I call this new history. And I'm not just here to tell you that mismanagement or inefficiency or corruption were not present in China's war effort, but what I am here to tell you is that there are vast continents of additional parts of the story that have not been located, much less explored, in the old literature. Now, Chiang Kai-shek, Mao Zedong, and a host of other Chinese leaders in the first half of the 20th century shared an ultimate goal of restoring China to greatness. This meant recovering her sovereignty, and this in turn ultimately meant war with Japan. Zheng was a professional soldier who had in fact trained in Japan and read Japanese. He fully comprehended that tackling Japan was an extremely formidable task, and there's abundant documentation now that from at least as early as 1932, he ordered wide-ranging preparations for such a war with Japan. Chinese military theorists, including publications by Zhang himself, determined that China could only prevail in such a war by luring Japan deep into the country and ultimately exhausting her in a war of attrition. But Zhang also grasped that psychological preparation was nearly as important as material preparations. It was essential to mobilize a large majority of China's fragmented population behind that cause and to restore the status of soldiers to the people. A popular saying in China at the beginning of the 20th century was, "You do not use good nails, good iron to make nails, or good men to make soldiers." Zheng predicted that the war with Japan would lead to a world war in which China would gain allies, which would permit her final triumph. In a speech in March 1934, he predicted that war would begin in 1,100 days, and he was off by 43 days. When the Marco Polo Bridge incident occurred in July 1937, Zheng met the Japanese escalation with a decision to commence the showdown. And this was no small gamble. In July 1937, China's Navy could not control smuggling, much less being able to take on the Imperial Japanese Navy. The Chinese air forces, such as they were typically ill-equipped and ill-trained. The one thing that China did have was a numerically large army, numbering about 2 million, whereas at that point, Japan's army numbered about 600,000. The problem was that China's armies were of highly variegated capability and loyalty to Zheng. An examination of this Chinese order of battle in July 1937 tells us not only about China's ground capabilities, but also provides a great deal of insight in the political situation. China's loyal and immediate forces were called the Central Army, and they numbered only about 300,000, of which about 80,000 were German trained and equipped. They were by far the most capable Chinese units at that time. A second stratum of the Chinese army numbered about 600,000. These included various regional commands loyal to Zheng in the past, who generally conformed to his directives. These troops were better armed and trained than the rest. The third category involved regional armies mustering about roughly 1 million men, almost literally half the soldiers that China could place in the field. They were neither loyal nor obedient to Zheng, and most indifferently led, as well as poorly trained and equipped. Among them were about 50,000 members of the Red Army, of which, however, only about 30,000 actually had weapons. And for those of you obsessed with math, that tells you that the Chinese communists at that point had about 1.5% of all Chinese under arms. And finally, there were perhaps 250,000 strong armies who were from northeastern China, Manchuria, which basically had been driven out of their home areas by the Japanese. And these outfits generally either disintegrated or became bandits or even became collaborationist forces with the Japanese. And that's basically the Chinese order of battle. Now, what's even more important, I think, in our understanding of what's happening in China is to understand what this tells us politically about what's happening in China. And the key point, of course, is that Zheng was actually the head of a divided and very difficult coalition. He was not the master of a unified and compliant political community. And second, and I will return to this a little later, Chinese communists at this point were a very tiny minority within the spectrum of Chinese political and military constellations in 1937. Now, qualitatively, Japan's ground forces had a huge superiority. The Japanese, to begin with, possessed enormously superior firepower at the divisional level. This table shows what is really a nominal Japanese division, which was pretty close to reality in the field. The Chinese division is really sort of the ideal. This is one of the best of the Central Army divisions, of which there were fewer than 20 who were so armed at this point. It shows you the Japanese had a very significant level of firepower superiority. Probing further, what's even more striking to me about the capabilities of Chinese armed forces on the ground at this time is that whereas when Japan modernized, it established a complete military educational system. That should sound familiar here. They had not only a military academy for junior officers, but also staff colleges, and it turned out highly trained, highly complimented staff officers. One of the greatest deficiencies that the Chinese had at that time was they really had no adequate cadre of staff officers. So even if a Chinese unit enjoyed a very capable commander, making that commander's vision effective down the nervous system of a large unit was extremely difficult for lack of competent staff officers. It particularly made coordination between adjacent Chinese units extremely difficult, which was a weakness that the Japanese exploited again and again and again. Frank Dorn, an American military observer, calculated the average Japanese division possessed from 3 to 12 times as much combat power as its Chinese equivalent. The Japanese used a rule of thumb, which was that a single Japanese regiment was capable of grappling on a relatively even basis with a full Chinese division of the Central Army, the best troops. And a single Japanese battalion, well, they could take on a division of some of these regional army forces. Shanks chose to stage the first great battle of the war in Shanghai. He did not do this because he had hopes of immediate Western intervention, as sometimes alleged. He knew there was very little prospect of that. He chose Shanghai because fighting in North China, which was a relatively open area, would enhance every Japanese advantage and maximize every Chinese handicap, and because the regional forces in North China were among his least effective and least obedient. Shanghai in 1937 was what New York was to the United States. It was the great center of commerce, communications, and a hub of intellectual activity. Now, Shanghai featured a congested urban setting surrounded by cut-up terrain that minimized Japanese superiority and mobility and firepower and maximized the effectiveness of the Chinese forces, which were numerous but deployed few weapons larger than machine guns. The Battle of Shanghai was huge. Before it's over, there are about 750,000 Chinese troops committed at Shanghai. The Japanese will commit about 250,000 troops by the end of the campaign. It was, as far as I can tell, the largest battle fought within a city during what we call the Second World War prior to Stalingrad in 1942. Now, when the Battle of Shanghai began, outside observers and the Japanese anticipated that once Japan committed significant forces, the Chinese would be smashed, as was the pattern for Chinese arms for nearly a century at that point. But the Chinese held on. News of the battle rocketed across China and secured one of Shang's most important strategic goals for waging the battle in Shanghai, and that is the mobilization of the Chinese masses behind what became known as the War of Resistance. As days became weeks and then weeks became months, the Japanese became increasingly troubled at explaining what was going on. Finally, there was this classic moment involving a New York Times reporter who asked a Japanese spokesperson to explain this protracted campaign. And he gets the following quote, "In explanation of the slowness of their progress around Shanghai, the Japanese complain that the Chinese, ignorant of tactics, did not know when to retreat." As Zhang later admitted, however, he made a terrible mistake in the closing stages of the battle in not ordering an orderly withdrawal. The Chinese finally smashed resistance in Shanghai in November 1937, and the Chinese armies retreated in disarray. Chinese losses are believed to have numbered approximately 170,000 or more killed and wounded. Japanese losses totaled about 40,000, including about 9,000 deaths. Within these numbers, however, there was a grimmer story about the first Japanese units that entered Shanghai. In particular, the 9th Division sustained total casualties that equaled 94% of the division's original strength. Only the mobilization of reservists kept that unit and others going. With the fall of Shanghai, Tokyo considered halting operations in China, but in a pattern that would be repeated throughout the campaigns in China, the field commanders were led on by the mirage that if they could take Nanjing, the nationalist capital, they would deliver a knockout blow that would halt Chinese resistance and secure Japan a bounty of concessions. The Japanese soldiers were turned loose to march the 274 kilometers from Shanghai to Nanjing. They were not given any food. Their only recourse was to plunder the Chinese. And that march turned into one long, terrible scroll of abuse, looting, rape, and murder. Although some resistance was put up in Nanjing, the Japanese soldiers broke into the city on December 13, 1937, and what followed has been called the Rape of Nanjing. The ultimate death toll cannot now be stated with confidence, in my view. And the People's Republic, they literally have carved in stone numbers over 300,000. Generally speaking, the recent Western scholarship, which does not at all dispute that something terribly bad on a vast scale occurred in Nanjing, has suggested that they can't find evidence to think support numbers above about 100,000 deaths, but less than 200,000. I'm now of rather two minds about the Nanjing massacre. On the one hand, it served to resurface the horrors of this war that never should have been left to descend into obscurity. On the other hand, in my view, to the degree to which the emphasis is placed on Nanjing distorts our understanding because it focuses our attention on one admittedly horrific episode and a vastly broader canvas of Chinese sacrifice. Now, Japan committed two huge strategic errors within the weeks between December 1937 and January 1938. The reports of widespread atrocities, of which to the Chinese at this time, Nanjing had not yet achieved the level it was going to achieve later, only served to rouse the Chinese population to further resistance. And meanwhile, rather than use supple diplomacy to negotiate an end to the conflict, the Chinese raised their terms, demanding effectively Chinese thraldom. When Zhang rejected such terms, the Chinese declared that they would no longer treat Zhang as the legitimate ruler of China. They soon learned that when the Chinese did not stop fighting, they lacked a diplomatic option. In the early months of 1938, virtually the entire world, including Tokyo, believed that China would now submit to whatever demands the Japanese made and that a disgraced Zhang would fall from power. But Zhang met with his senior commanders in January 1938, and they resolved that they would continue the fight according to the pre-war strategy of drawing the Japanese into the interior and exhausting them. Their immediate plan was to defend Wuhan, a tri-city area up the Yangtze River from Nanjing. Although Tokyo looked in early 1938 for a pause, once again, the field commanders insisted on continuing the campaign towards Wuhan. There were a series of battles along the approaches to Wuhan from the east and north. The Chinese fighting stubbornly at a rail junction called Taizhuang, I don't know whether I got that right, but probably close enough, achieved a remarkable victory, which served to recharge Chinese morale and indicate that the Chinese were not about to give up. In June 1938, to block an advance by a major Japanese thrust, Zhang ordered the destruction of dikes of the Yellow River. This unleashed a huge flood, which is believed to have caused the deaths of at least 500,000 Chinese, with some numbers advanced as high as 900,000. It's been argued this was the greatest environmental disaster of World War II, and I would suggest to you that it would be impossible to imagine that an event like this could have happened in European theaters and none of you had ever heard about it. Meanwhile, in Wuhan, there took place perhaps one of the most remarkable periods in 20th century Chinese history. There was an astonishing freedom of expression and association, a genuine democratic atmosphere. This has attracted the attention of Western scholars and stands, perhaps, as an important historical marker on a long road that China may yet travel towards democracy. After months of hard battles, some of which the Japanese won using poison gas, as they were wont to do during the war, Wuhan finally fell to the Japanese in October 1938. While Imperial headquarters in Tokyo started the year 1938 confident that the war would soon be ended, not even the victory at Wuhan was able to lift from them a depression as they realized they no longer had the power to enforce an end to the war by military means alone. Now, while these great battles were taking place in the foreground of the war of resistance, particularly in the first 2 years, something else was happening in China, what's been described as the greatest migration in human history. China's pre-war population was usually put somewhere in the vicinity of 450, 480 million. The Chinese overran all or parts of 21 of 30 provinces in China with a population perhaps of about 180 million. And although numbers as low as 3 million and as high as 95 million have been advanced as the number of refugees during the war, I tend to go with one scholar's judicious estimate that puts the number at about 45 million, which is still a fantastical number. The Japanese occupied areas of China from Manchuria to the Indochina border. This included essentially the key parts, the key ports along the seacoast, and an extension inland along the major rivers like the Yellow River and the Yangtze. The frontage at the end of this expansion in the last months of 1938 was basically about equal to the whole United States west east of the Mississippi. These regions were both the most economically developed areas of China and contained the vast majority of China's urbanized and westernized population. They featured the nation's intellectual elite as well as most of its colleges and universities. In other words, the Japanese overran the most modernized and sophisticated areas of China. The effects of this mass flight of refugees remained obscured, but was one of the greatest tragedies of the war. In the 4,000-year-old history of China, certainly there had been colossal prior upheavals and devastation. To give just one example, in the Taiping Rebellion in 1850, 1864, it's believed that as many as 30 million Chinese died. Yet, none of these earlier struggles had covered such a vast expanse of China or inflicted such colossal levels of devastation. As one famous Chinese paper at the time put it, quote, this is, quote, the first war of the entire nation in Chinese history. In comparison, all these those preceding were merely partial wars, unquote. As news spread across China, in the areas that are overrun, the Japanese were routinely killing all males of military age and wreaking terrible deeds upon Chinese females. The Chinese people realized that this struggle was not just some new iteration of rather ancient human impulses towards territorial aggrandizement. Instead, they confronted what they viewed as a stark race war in which the Japanese regarded them as a lower order of being. And the response was this massive movement of people from the interior to escape the Japanese. The marches proved longer and more exhausting than most migrants anticipated. As a result, the path of the marchers was littered with the sick, the lame, the old, exhausted, as well as children left to die. A journalist, Frieda Utley, reported that it was not uncommon for a family to start the march with five or six children and end it with one or two. Historians Diane O'Leary and Stephen McKinnon have argued that this migration and the violence unleashed by the war as a whole struck a devastating blow at the fundamental structure of Chinese civilization. It destroyed the multi-generational family living under one roof, and its effect was an atomization of Chinese society that would open the door to some of Mao's most disastrous experiments during his nearly three decades of rule. But the war also produced another effect. Throughout the thousands of years of Chinese history, the central government had only two obligations in the realm of what we probably would call social welfare. The first of these was to maintain the dikes along the great rivers to prevent flooding, and the second of these was to duty to maintain grain reserves against famine. All other types of relief in China up to that point, from man-made or natural disasters, rested basically in the hands of provincial governments or local governments, private benefactors, and some regional associations. During the war, Jiang's central government accepted responsibility for refugee relief and thus created a precedent of the national government to assume vastly greater roles in the national level of health and welfare. One of the problems that arose from this, however, was that as the nationalists faced the dilemma of having assumed much greater responsibilities, at the same time, the revenue base of the Chinese government was collapsing. In the long run, the nationalists found themselves not gaining credit for having expanded a sense of obligation to their fellow Chinese, but instead garnering much blame for the inability to meet rising expectations. Over the next several years, the front line in China essentially stabilized. The Japanese had decided to embark upon a three-pronged strategy to bring the war to a conclusion. The first prong of the Japanese strategy was to stabilize and hopefully reduce her forces in China. Those troops in China would revert to the fundamental mission of consolidation of the areas Japan held. The Japanese, however, never had enough troops in China, and the most they could do was what was called holding points and lines, which is to say urban centers and the communications lines between them. The second effort of the Japanese was political. They attempted to set up a rival Chinese government in the areas they dominated. There were a number of these, the most significant of which was one headed by Wang Jingwei, who was Zhang's longtime rival, who had gone over to the Japanese. He was sort of the Chinese Benedict Arnold of the War of Resistance. However, the Japanese hopelessly compromised him over the terms that they were willing to give him to set up his government, and he never secured much traction. The third prong of the Japanese strategy was strangulation. The Japanese recognized that Zhang and a large part of the population were grimly hanging on to the hope that other nations would intervene in the war. The Japanese sought to cut off China physically from all outside support. They reasoned this would not only reduce the Chinese military effort in the short term, but also in the long term, it might serve to help collapse the Chinese will to continue the war. The Japanese took a giant step towards isolating China in the fall of 1938 when they captured the city that's usually called in the West Canton. This was a very heavy blow to the Chinese because it was the principal port for receiving war supplies. Now, one of the least understood aspects about the Japanese effort in China was the effects of this blockade. The reason why it was so devastating was not just because it cut off actual military supplies flowing to the Chinese, which, of course, was a very important and intended effect. But the other aspect of this was that prior to the war, the Chinese central government derived about half of its revenues from customs duties. By cutting off the ports and cutting off the customs duties, the Japanese struck a devastating blow at the finances of the central government. After the fall of Canton, the Chinese were left with basically four basic supply lines. One was from the Soviet Union down from the north. The Soviets supplied a lot of material from 1937 to 39. The second of these was the port of Haiphong in French Indochina and a rail line that led up to South China. The third was Hong Kong. And the fourth was the Burma Road linking Western China with the outside world. The opening of the Burma Road roughly coincided with the loss of Canton. We don't really have completely accurate figures in the tonnage reaching Chinese resisting Japan along these sources, but what is abundantly clear is that what had been available in 1937 and 1938 trickled to a very small fraction of that number in the following years. One bright side for Chinese armed forces from 1939 onward was that they finally developed an operational and tactical technique that was able to secure for them some successes against the Japanese. And I would call this technique the counterpunch. And basically what they realized was that the Japanese great weakness was logistics, and the technique that they used as the Japanese launched offensives in these following years was basically not to confront head-on a Japanese offensive, but to let the Japanese come onward while they massed Chinese forces on the Japanese flanks. Then after about a week or 10 days, after the Japanese had exhausted a lot of the supplies they man-ported forward, then the Chinese would fall on their flanks and rear. And with this technique, they secured a number of important successes. In 1939, the Japanese and the Soviets had a conflict at a place called Nomahan in Manchuria. The Japanese were trounced, and this is usually depicted as an unalloyed benefit to the nations facing the Axis. However, if you look carefully at what happened as a result of Nomahan, one of the most important effects was it convinced Stalin that he needed to make sure he didn't get into a two-front war, so he signed that pact with Hitler in August 1939. One part of that agreement, or one of the results of that agreement, was that the Soviets began trickling down the amount of support they were giving to the Chinese. At the same time, by signing that pact, Stalin gave a writ to Hitler, which Hitler used in the spring of 1940, to overrun Western Europe. This, of course, was not what Stalin intended, but basically Stalin had succeeded, on the one hand, enabling Hitler to overrun Western Europe, and also to reduce the resistance of the Chinese, who potentially were tying down his Japanese opponents. The German triumph in Europe in 1940 also had one other very important effect on the war in China, and that is that the Japanese seized the opportunity presented by the collapse of the French to prevail upon the Vichy government to close down the route from Indochina into South China. This was one of the most important routes along which the Chinese received support. Now, the year 1940 also became an important part of the War of Resistance because it brought one important Japanese tactic and technique to a new crescendo. At the beginning of the war, the Japanese had enjoyed air superiority. They had also, in the course of their operations, commenced an extensive bombing campaign against Japanese Chinese cities. In 1940, however, the Japanese decided to mass both Imperial Army and Imperial Navy bombers and launch a mass campaign they called Operation 101 against the Chinese wartime capital, Chongqing. Historian H.P. Wilmot has called this the first real strategic bombing campaign in history. The Japanese unblushingly aimed to use terror to break the will of the Chinese people. And they renewed this effort in 1941 in what they called Operation 102. And they continued that down to September 1941, and they began to withdraw aircraft for their campaigns against the Western powers. The Japanese air bombardment of Chongqing smashed or burned vast swaths of the city. It's believed to have killed about 15,000 residents of Chongqing. By way of contrast, about 20,000 Londoners died during the war. And now I come to the Chinese communists. You've probably been wondering, why have we not talked about the Chinese communists at this point? Well, basically what the new history illuminates is the following. At the start of the war, the Chinese had communists had about 30,000 men who had actual weapons. And this was about 1.5% of all Chinese under arms. The main base area, the one where Mao was at in northwest China, had about 1.4 million persons living in it. This is about 0.3% of China's population. A little later, Zhang bestowed recognition on a separate 12,000-man guerrilla, or basically guerrilla unit called the New Fourth Army. Mao was severely critical of Zhang's willingness to engage in conventional battle with the Japanese. Instead, he dictated absolute priority to guerrilla operations, or what he called Sparrow War. He did this, by the way, over the opposition of a number of his subordinates who wanted to participate much more in a conventional style operations against the Japanese. Now, Mao's strategy, of course, fitted the capabilities of the Red Army at the start of the war, and they increasingly secured control of these areas where the Japanese had ostensibly gained occupation, but in fact actually had no control. By early 1940, the Chinese Communist Armed Forces probably numbered somewhere close to half a million. One of the most remarkable documents that has come to light was found by Jay Taylor, a biographer of Chiang Kai-shek, who had the wit to go to Moscow to look in the Moscow archives to see what was to be found there. And there he found a report submitted over the signature of Zhou Enlai in January 1940. It was sent to the Comintern and Stalin, reporting on the progress of the war for the first 2 years by the Chinese communists. In this report, Zhao stated that 1 million Chinese soldiers had been killed or wounded in the war in the period that he described, which was basically from July of 37 to August of 1939. And then he went on to itemize that of that number, 31,000 had been members of Red Army units. This is just 3% of all Chinese military casualties. In August 1940, the Red Army mounted their sole major conventional operation of the war, the so-called 100 Regiments campaign. It achieved some initial success, but the Japanese reaction was absolutely savage. They transferred units to counterattack the Red Army and loosed a terror campaign against Chinese civilians, known as the Three All campaign, burn all, kill all, loot all. Chinese communist military units are believed to have suffered about 20,000 casualties, and the civilians suffered far, far worse. Thereafter, the Red Army mounted no major conventional operations throughout the rest of the war. Another report of the same ilk to Moscow in December 1944 said that up to that date, the Chinese Communist main force, which was the 8th Route Army, had sustained a total of 103,189 fatalities. Now, no doubt there were also thousands of additional casualties among Red Army guerrilla units, not within the main force. Nonetheless, by that point, if Chinese military fatalities overall are probably approaching somewhere in the vicinity of 3 million, Chinese communist military casualties still are somewhere in the vicinity of 3%, 5%, somewhere like that. In my view, although it would be wrong to say the Chinese communists were not doing anything, they certainly were tying down the Japanese with their guerrilla operations. These documents pretty much put the kibosh on the idea that it was the communists who were doing all the fighting and not the nationalists. One historian has described that the nationalists in 1940 were on their knees, as it looked like Chiang's vision of allies to eventually overcome the Japanese seemed to be collapsing as Hitler knocked out Britain and France. The nationalists, however, did not stop fighting. There were three major campaigns in 1940. The Japanese were basically defeated in two of them. Meanwhile, in 1941, the whole geopolitical situation underwent a radical shift with a German attack on the Soviet Union. And at this point, especially after late July 1941, when it began to appear that the Soviet Union would in fact hold out, the value of China to the Western Allies enormously increased because it became obvious that it was very important to keep the Japanese pinned down so they could not also come in against the Soviet Union. As a result of that, the U.S. began to promise some lend-lease for China, although little, if any, of it actually reached the Chinese before the end of the year. The news of the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor brought rejoicing in China. It seemed at last that China was now part of a coalition with powerful allies, that the Japanese must soon be defeated. But the Japanese launched a stunning rampage across Asia that soon had the United Kingdom and the United States reeling. And worse yet, the Japanese soon had China even more isolated than before. At the time of Pearl Harbor, the Chinese had only two significant supply routes still remaining. One of these ran through Hong Kong. Although the Chinese, or Chiang, had asked the British to pre-plan and pre-position forces to help defend Hong Kong, the British refused for political reasons. The British then indicated that they would hold out in Hong Kong for a month while the Chinese massed their forces to come to their rescue. Hong Kong fell after 17 days, and it was gone as a conduit to China. This left only the route through Burma. And with this, we enter onto the stage, Joseph W. Stilwell, the American proconsul. He basically was sort of a token of our interest because there was little else the US could do besides send tokens. The only outfit that was fighting as an American unit in this phase of the war was, of course, the famous Flying Tigers under Claire Chennault. They were probably the only effective Allied unit fighting in Southeast Asia in the first months of the war. And their success may have been overstated in some respects, but it was very real, and it was not the creation of skillful publicity. The British first rejected Chiang's efforts, offers of troops to defend Burma. Once again, they were concerned that if the Chinese got into Burma, it would have political implications the British Empire did not like. In the end, however, the British finally saw the light and agreed to have Chinese send troops. Chiang sent two of his armies, which were more like a Western Corps-sized unit. He said they were his best troops, and he was right, they were. They included his only mechanized division. The Japanese, in their accounts of the campaign, are in the position of giving grades at the end of the campaign as to what's happened, and they gave the highest marks to the Chinese in resistance in Burma. Now we come to the story of Joseph Stilwell, and this is an area in which basically my preconceptions about what had happened underwent one of the strongest, if not the strongest, revision. Stilwell reached China and Burma in March of 1942. By that point, Rangoon in Burma had been lost. Stilwell proposed an offensive by Chinese and British Commonwealth forces to retake Rangoon. Now, superficially, this looks sound. This would be a paper one of your students might tune in a couple of weeks from now. Hopefully, they'll get better as they go along. Okay, Burma basically is sort of like a cul-de-sac or a walk-in closet. Right? The open end is where Rangoon is, facing the Indian Ocean. All the major communications at that time ran north, south, rail, road, water. Communications either to the west to India or to the east to China, crossing over mountains, are very limited. So taking and holding Rangoon seemed to be the thing to do to, quote, hold Burma. When Stilwell talks to Zhang. As you read the back and forth, Zhang's take was very different. Zhang said, first of all, the Japanese have air and sea superiority. Secondly, the British Commonwealth forces in India, in Burma by this point, are of very low combat value. And Zhang is entirely correct on that point. Zhang further says, my armies are my best, but they're not man-for-man a match for the Japanese. I think our soundest strategy at this point would be to try to hold a line through about central Burma to try to maintain ground on which a land link between India and China can be established or reestablished. And oh, by the way, Zhang says to Stilwell, I think your estimate of how many Japanese there are in Burma is way too low, and Zhang is exactly right. Well, you look at these two estimates of the situation and you see that basically Stilwell is basically a pipe dream and Zhang is a lot sounder in his judgment. Now, I would not tell you that had they followed Zhang's strategy, everything would have come out well, because the Japanese were absolutely determined that they were going to isolate China by knocking out the Burma Road and taking Burma. And if they'd met some initial setbacks, I'm pretty sure the Japanese would have sent more forces to do the job in Burma. But nonetheless, in terms of what was available and what could be done, Zhang was correct, and Stilwell, it seems to me, was quite wrong. I would further suggest to you that how do you think the Chinese viewed Stilwell after this episode? As a great American coming in to explain to them how to conduct war, or as a guy who seemed to be basically out of touch with what was going on? And you can take this one step further. If the Chinese were at their best in a counterpunch strategy and at their worst in direct offensive operations, and if the Japanese are at their best fighting defensively with secure logistics, what was Stilwell proposing? Basically to have the Allies do the thing they were least capable of doing against the Japanese in their ideal position. Not only that, this campaign ends in a disaster. And at the end of it, Stilwell gains great publicity for his famous walkout from Burma. Let's look at it from the Chinese side. He walks out from Burma with a party of slightly over 100. Now, I wouldn't take anything away from Stilwell for this accomplishment, but if you look at the composition of this party, there are about 18 Chinese in it. So from Zhang's standpoint, and the Chinese standpoint, it's this. Stilwell went into Burma with two Chinese armies and walked out with two squads. Is there something wrong with this picture? And we know now that Zhang very seriously thought about asking for the recall and replacement of Stilwell. He was talked out of it by Madame Zhang, and also by the fact that General Marshall gave a glowing endorsement to Stilwell's performance. I'm not going to tell you that it wasn't a panacea to get rid of Stilwell, but basically I think things would have been better in certain respects. It still would have been replaced at that point. And from the Chinese standpoint, there was ample reason to do so. Now, from 1942 to 1945, the most significant aspect about this story of the United States and China is simply one of logistics. Once the Japanese completed the capture of Burma, they achieved their premier strategic goal, which was effectively the complete isolation of China by sea and land from its allies. The remaining supply line to what the U.S. called the China-Burma-India Theater was by a huge margin the worst of the war faced by the U.S. Let me give you a more concrete, typical example. Let's suppose we're going to ship an item to China and we load it on a ship in New York or New Jersey. I'm sorry, I just got out of, I think something went off here. There we go. The extremely long looping down line is the route from East Coast US ports up to the then available port, which was Karachi, now Pakistan, which was then India. This is a distance of over 21,000 kilometers, and basically it would take the average ship at that time traveling at its best speed and partly in convoy about 2 months to reach Karachi. Once the convoy reached, the cargo reached Karachi, it would be offloaded from the ship onto the Indian rail system to travel about 1,800 kilometers to airfields in northwest India. Let me go back up here. I'm sorry. airfields in northwest India to be flown over to China. Now, the Indian rail system from Karachi to these airfields involved four changes of gauge. At each change, there had to be hand labor to move stuff from one train to another. When the train reached eastern India, the major rivers were not bridged. The trains had to be broken down to taken across on ferries. Once it got to the airfields in northwest India, it was flown across to China, typically in Kunming. The time taken to move from Karachi to China was also about 8 weeks. So basically, to get one item from the US to China took the better part of one third of a year. The route over from India to China came into existence because President Roosevelt promised continued US support in the form of an airlift after Burma fell. The flight route from those airfields into China was about 1,100 kilometers over part of the Himalayas, which at the area they tried to cross measured about 1,500 feet or about 4,500 kilometers in height. This route became popularly known to Americans as Over the Hump, and the airmen also referred to it as the Aluminum Trail because it was paved with the wreckage of ultimately about 594 aircraft, in which about 910 American airmen perished. The effort began in April 1945 with just 13 aircraft on the inventory and gradually grew in stages in the following years. They went from a pitiful monthly figure of about 400 tons, which represented a breakthrough in 1942. They crossed the 10,000-ton mark in December 1943 and was to soar and reach a high rate of efficiency in late 1944 and 1945, peaking at 71,000 tons in July 1945. By then, the Hump was a huge enterprise involving 750 planes and over 4,000 pilots. The best figures on the tonnage hauled on the Hump were about 738,000 tons. Now, to put this into perspective, I prepared two slides, which this is from the Army Service Forces, one of their publications describing. They call it international aid. It's basically lend-lease. It shows you where it went. You'll see the British got 62%, the Soviets got 25%, the French got 5%, everybody else got 4%, and the Chinese got 4% of all the U.S. aid to China. In addition to that, here are two other ways of looking at it. If we take just the lend-lease aid to the Soviet Union of over 17 million tons, and compare that to what gets over the Hump to China, you'll see it's about 4% of what goes to the Soviet Union. I also looked up, these are eastbound loaded ships sailing from the US to the UK, and reduced that to Liberty ship equivalents, about 7,000 tons each, and you'll see that that equaled about 0.7% of what we were sending to the UK. Now, as bad as these numbers look, from the standpoint of Zhang and the nationalist government, it was even worse. Because, you see, all that tonnage that goes over the Hump is not going to Zhang and the nationalist government. It is overwhelmingly going to support General Claire Chennault's airmen, leader of the 14th Air Force in China. It goes to sustain the American presence in China, diplomatic and military. It goes to support General Stilwell's program to train certain selected Chinese divisions. And it goes to an ill-conceived idea of basing B-29s out of China for attacks on Japan. According to the best student of the Hump, John Plating, an Air Force officer, basically, Zhang and his outfit received about 5% of all the Hump tonnage that got to China. In January 1945, Stilwell completed his campaign to clear northern Burma, and the engineers completed what became known as the Lido and later the Stilwell Road. Its first convoy was in January 1945, and although various tonnage figures are given for this over those following months, the fact is that those tonnage figures actually include the weight of the trucks that were driven to China, all of which stayed in China, although the Chinese needed trucks. And basically about 75 to 90%, depending on the numbers you want to look at, of the tonnage going over the road to China was trucks, not supplies. Hump tonnage was net tonnage, actual delivered items to China. basically plating points out, and this one definitely shocked me. He said that, so the green eye shake guys, or what we used to call the green eye shake guys that sat down and did these things, calculated that it was more efficient to fly things over the hump than it was to drive them across the Lido-Stilwell Road to China, which raises a whole separate set of questions about the whole effort to clear North Burma. Now, let me conclude by going over what I think are the most important aspects about the strategic significance of China during the Second World War. The first thing I would emphasize, and I can't emphasize enough, is that just China getting in and sustaining itself for 8 years of war was a stupendous achievement, given where China started from and the ruthlessness of the enemy it was facing. And we simply cannot neglect or criticize China without first acknowledging that this was a stupendous achievement. The second thing is that China's role in the global struggle was also an important part political. Remember, Japan's banner was that it was out to liberate Asia, Asia for the Asians or whatever here. The fact that the Chinese took up and maintained arms against the Japanese, as well as the efforts later by the Filipinos, was an extremely important political dimension to the Asia-Pacific War. The next thing was that China was really the catalyst for the U.S. entry into the Second World War. I've been going over the diplomatic dance in 1941 between the U.S. and Japan. The things that really pop out to me now that when you think about China's role in this are, first of all, that after mid-1941, when it seemed to be obvious the Soviets might survive and the role of China became extremely important, China was not expendable from the U.S. standpoint, yet the Japanese terms on which they were seeking to secure a settlement with the U.S. insisted upon the defeat of China, which the U.S. could not possibly agree upon, and that led down the path to Pearl Harbor. And Pearl Harbor not only got the U.S. into the war, but very importantly, it also got a united and determined population behind the war effort. The fourth contribution of China was that it tied down large numbers of Japanese troops. I had this, and this is sort of my thought process being in a photograph or whatever here. This is a table, probably about as accurate as we're going to get, about the distribution of Japanese troops during World War II. And you'll notice that the number of Japanese who are tied down in China goes from about 680,000 to about 1.2 million. The Chinese like to emphasize this above all, at least Chinese scholars right now like to emphasize this above all. This is a little deceptive because the Japanese simply didn't have the shipping to take all these guys and just move them anywhere they wanted to. But suppose they took, say, another 30,000 guys and put them into Saipan to double the garrison there, or Iwo Jima, or Okinawa. You can see that this was of no small consequence in terms of American casualties in the war. In conclusion, I would like to emphasize that what I've only done is try to highlight some of the aspects about what this new history shows about China during World War II. And the perspective these highlights serves to advance is both that the Chinese contribution and Chinese suffering were immense and should be remembered and not forgotten. Thank you.
You mentioned Stilwell and U.S. advisors to China. I know other nations had advisors to China as well. In the 30s, at least at some point, the Germans were there. I believe the Soviets had some advisors at various points. The British had advisors as well. Can you comment on them?
Right. Zhang, in particular, relied upon German advisors. He had them and trusted them until Hitler had them removed in 1938 in line with his diplomacy with the Japanese. Interestingly, Zhang and his principal German advisor communicated in the only language they shared, which was Japanese. The role of the German advisors in particular is sort of a sore point about whether they helped or hindered the Chinese war effort. We know that the Germans, for instance, were pretty strong in urging Shang that it was time to take on the Japanese at Shanghai in 1937. The Soviets came in, and in their version, they're primarily responsible for some of the Chinese successes. I think there's probably some substance to this, but I think the Chinese were quite capable of figuring a lot of this out. The Americans were there primarily as observers. I'm still working through a lot of this stuff because obviously the whole advisor, attaché, diplomat, and journalist issue, which gets into this who lost China brouhaha that comes later. I have seen some stuff that has really stunned me in terms of the naivety of some of the Americans in these various capacities in China in the 1940s with respect to the Chinese communists. The final report that Stilwell turns in when he's relieved in the fall of 1944 goes on and describes a lot of problems with the Chinese nationalists, which, once again, I have no trouble with anyone accurately describing that. But he goes on, and when he comes to the Chinese communists, he describes them, and I'm almost quoting literally here, that they are idealists who seek to bring democracy and freedom to China, which I think is slightly off. Over here.
Same topic. It's 2 points. Why did Marshall like Stilwell? The Brits clearly didn't, and they're very critical about his capabilities. And then why has it taken 70 years for historians to catch on?
You know, let me start off, first of all, with basically Stilwell at his best, and I think this is a story worth remembering. When Churchill comes over for the first wartime conference in the U.S. in December 41, January 42, Arcadia, one of the most important projects that's then under consideration is a landing in North Africa. And the American commander designate for the lander in North Africa initially is Joseph W. Stilwell. And in an important sense, we can see this as a moment in which Stilwell is posed, at least ostensibly, standing before that ladder that Dwight D. Eisenhower is going to climb to Supreme Command in Europe and the presidency. The problem was that Stilwell was totally incapable of being an Allied commander. He is the anti-Eisenhower. Now, that said, they attempt to get General Yu Drum to go to China in charge of the mission. Drum says the job is not big enough for him. You can imagine how that goes over with Marshall. They turn to Stilwell and say, we want you to go. And he simply says, I'll go where I'm sent, like a good soldier. Well, in my view, this is really more than a good soldier, because they all understood, if not exactly what was going to happen, they understood that Stilwell was giving down what probably would have been the premier assignment, field assignment in the U.S. Army, a chance for great fame, glory, historical memory, to go off on a mission that they knew was not going to end well. Gerhard Weinberg has made, I think, the very astute observation at the human level that basically General Marshall and Secretary of War Henry Stimson never forgot the debt they owed to Stilwell for having done this, that he'd fallen on his sword for them to go off on this mission, which is an important reason why they continued to back him for as long as they did. There were Americans who said that there was a problem with Stilwell as an Allied commander. The man just seemed to have inside himself this cauldron of hates. It comes out in his diary entries, and he couldn't keep his mouth shut about it. You know, he had contempt for Shang. It's one thing to have contempt for your ostensible ally. It's another thing to mouth this around so much it gets all the way back to Marshall. Marshall knows what's going on. But the other problem we have, and this, I think, really has shaped the sort of version of history, is if you look at the Army Green Book history of the China-Burma-India Theater, and I can't speak highly enough about that Green Book series. It's just a phenomenal piece of work, I think. But if you look at the source notes for the first volume, and as usual, they have absolutely mined to the nth degree U.S. archives. On the Chinese side, they list six secondary sources, of which three of which are pure anti-Shang venom. There simply is no access to documentation. If you don't have some version of the Chinese side of these events, and all you have is the version of Stilwell and his acolytes or whatever here, That was the version of history we were given for all these years, and that's why it took until this stuff began coming out for us to realize what, you know, that there was more to the story than Stilwell's version. Stilwell would have made an outstanding division commander or corps commander in a solely American setting, probably. He'd made a hell of a regimental commander, but, you know, he was already a three-star.
Excuse me, could I do a follow-up about Stilwell? First off, I'm not necessarily to defend him, but Slim says that in his memoirs that he got along famously with Stilwell, and there are numerous pictures of Slim walking around Burma carrying the M1 carbine that Stilwell gave him. Secondly, what about Wiedemeyer? Wiedemeyer took over after Stilwell. He had some very controversial, in retrospect, views of the capabilities of the Chinese. Perhaps he went to the other extreme. What do you think?
We mentioned Slim, who I think is, at least in my view, the finest British field commander in World War II. When you look at what he accomplished with what he had compared to Montgomery. One of the really telling episodes about Slim and his memoirs is he's in this first Burma campaign when he, by force of personality, holds together this defeated British army, which is going to do the longest retreat in British army history. You'll notice, however, that one of the things he does while he's there in Burma is he's got these Chinese generals around he has to deal with, and he observes that, you know, they've been fighting the Japanese for quite a while, and, you know, they just might have some ideas that might be useful about how to fight the Japanese. And he listens carefully, and of course they emphasize that logistics is the great Japanese weakness, which is something Slim is going to pull from years later. It's that open-mindedness of Slim, among his many other characteristics, that I think is so admirable. And he was one of the few Brits who did get along very well with Stilwell. I think Stilwell, of course, was a great detester of anything that was pompous or arrogant, which describes a lot of Brits of that era or whatever here. And we Americans, that resonates with us. I mean, that's one of the aspects about his as a personality, why he's enjoyed such a good press or whatever here. And your point about Wiedemeyer, yeah, he goes sort of the other way. To be fair to Wiedemeyer, a lot of his reports about Chiang and the Nationalists are accurate on specific faults. The two recent, I think, best studies of this by Jay Taylor, the Generalissimo, and the other book by Rana Netter out of Oxford called The Forgotten Ally. And they've had a chance to go through this material. And by no means are they whitewashing Chiang, but they both kind of reach what I think is sort of a very similar ultimate assessment. And basically they say that Chiang ultimately played a very bad hand about as well as it could have been played. And when you fully appreciate all the problems of China faced in World War II, I think you have to be a lot more sympathetic to him than we have been accustomed to be for seven decades.
Thank you, Richard, for that excellent presentation. Very late in the war, a new theater will be created, the Southeast Asia Theater under Lord Mountbatten. How does its creation affect the command arrangements, and how did Chiang perceive the desirability of setting up that command arrangement?
I think the overarching point for Chiang, by the time we get around to the Southeast Asia Command, this is another aspect about the war, is basically we can make a long list of faults and criticisms about Chiang and that, but if you look at the list of broken promises to the Chinese, it's really depressing to read. We're going to send them this, we don't, this, we don't, it's just a long. And ultimately, the biggest issue he had was, you know, he supports Stilwell's effort to reopen the Burma Road. He keeps insisting that this is going to involve a very large British effort, including an amphibious operation in Burma. He goes to the Cairo conference and meets with Roosevelt and Churchill and is promised right there on the spot that that amphibious operation is going to take place. And a couple weeks later, he's told, never mind. No, we're not going to do this after all. We've got these other plans. So he's, I'm not sure I'm prepared to give you a full explanation of exactly what Zhang thought about Mountbatten and the Southeast Asia Command. His larger issue was he simply thought the British had let him down repeatedly throughout the war and was not in a very favorable form of mind with them.